What I'm going to talk about in this segment is GOES-R and how the satellite has benefited from research. So we always talk about research to operations. Exactly what is that? In this particular segment, I'm going to talk about how the GOES-R sensors have been built upon research platforms that are up there and operating today. As a matter of fact, this particular cross-section of a satellite information has been pulled out from NASA satellites that are looking into the atmosphere. This particular side cross-section is from the CloudSat satellite, which is a very thin laser that points down to the Earth. Don't worry, it doesn't hurt anybody. It looks through the atmosphere, but what you can see is the vertical cross-section of wherever it flies over. So here's a particular thunderstorm in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, and a satellite can see that. These are all research areas that have benefited GOES-R in the development and evolution of its sensors. So we're going to talk a little bit about research to operations and how current satellites are out there now observing the Earth, what they're telling us. You can actually think about a satellite as a tool that a doctor has, right? When you go to the doctor, uses a stethoscope to listen to your heart, you get a physical. Satellites are the tools of atmospheric doctors. So they really give us a good picture of what's going on around the atmosphere. So I'm going to dive in a little bit and show you that, first of all, sea surface temperatures are very important to know when you're forecasting weather, when you're trying to figure out where areas are, where there could be possible development of tropical activity. So any area that you see in orange are temperatures at 80 degrees or above. This isn't live in the middle of winter, but an archived data set. But the cool thing is you can see, the Gulf Stream as it comes up the East Coast. We will be able to get more frequent sea surface temperature measurements from GOES-R, which is terrific. And that means that we can really start to average sea surface temperatures using data sets that are collected more frequently. So if we look at sea surface temperatures over a week today or over a month, we'll be able to see them over 5 minutes and 10 minutes because the data frequency in GOES-R is going to be so high. Now, we will have to get rid of clouds. Clouds don't allow us to see sea surface temperatures, but over a period of averaging, you can get rid of those clouds by using what's called cloud masking. So this is a sea surface temperatures. What's being observed right now are land temperatures. We've seen an increase in the land temperatures around the world, and so we can take a look at the temperatures from a global series of satellites, from polar orbiting satellites that go around. This is what's also benefiting that research to operations transfer. This is a land temperatures. Now we can also take a look at what's called NDVI, which is the Normalized Vegetation Index. It's basically the health of crops. We can see how things are growing around the world in the United States, Central America, South America. You can see the Amazon River, and in Brazil, how healthy, most healthy the forests are. Matter of fact, you're like, what's this circle right in here? It's deforestation, where trees have been cut down, and it's starting to show up big time in satellite data. So the trees aren't as healthy here because most of them are gone. And so if we back out here, we can take a look over in Africa and see where the growth is and where the desert is, where Saudi Arabia and the Middle East is. These are all deserts. But we can watch NDVI and we can watch the health of the vegetation, and we're going to be able to do that in the GOES-R era at a more frequent basis. Also, what's very important is water vapor. Water vapor in the atmosphere over the last decade has gone up 4% because of the increased temperatures around the world. And so a warmer Earth will hold more moisture. More moisture means when it rains, it can rain harder. When it snows, it can snow harder. So watching the water vapor around the world is critical. And we'll be able to do that not only like this with GOES-R, but we'll be able to do it in different levels of the atmosphere. So when GOES-R comes online, forecasters will be able to look at the water vapor at the low levels of the atmosphere and at the high levels of the atmosphere. And that makes a big difference for whether systems are increasing in intensity, have the energy to increase in intensity. This particular image is from the Global Rainfall Measuring Mission called TRIM, the Tropical Rainfall Measuring Mission. This is a polar orbiting satellite that measures the intensity of rain. so we can have global means and global averages of where the rain is falling, how intensely it's falling, what's happened with tropical systems, when it can see tropical systems and slice them into 3D. So there's a new satellite that's going to be launched next year, which is the Global Precipitation Mission, which is going to give us even more precipitation measurements at to the north. It's going to go to 60 degrees north and 60 degrees south. All of these from research satellites. The TRIM satellite has outlived its mission life, is still performing wonderfully. And one of the other things we need to be concerned about around the world is permafrost. What's going on with the permafrost around the world? Up in Canada, where they have buildings and communities there, we're starting to see that the permafrost is actually melting. And so when the permafrost melts, buildings start to tip. And they're already seeing indications of this in areas where the permafrost is melting and not solidifying back up to where it used to be. For example, in Alaska, where the Alaskan oil pipeline is, permafrost is melting. And it's starting to weaken part of the structure of the oil pipeline. So reinforcements have to be put in because that permafrost layer is being threatened and it's pulling back. And permafrost, as you may or may not know, sequesters or holds a whole lot of carbon, and it holds a whole lot of methane that's sequestered in that ice. So as permafrost melts, it begins to release that up into the atmosphere. And it could be a lot that it releases up in the atmosphere. So scientists are definitely studying that. This is an example of a proxy sea surface temperature data set provided by AER. And what AER did was they took a 5-day average of sea surface temperatures. They masked out the clouds, but wherever you see these black dots over a 5-day period, it was cloudy there. So when the clouds are there over a 5-day period, you get no information. But what's interesting is this period of time was 5 days before Hurricane Sandy formed in the Caribbean. As a matter of fact, it formed in this area right in here. And so when Sandy moved in this direction, you can see the sea surface temperatures that were warm enough to feed perhaps part of the storm. At least part of the potential energy from Sandy was drawn by warmer temperatures. And as it got up in here, the Gulf Stream still provided some warmth in the ocean. However, there was a lot of cool water as well. And as you know, Sandy transitioned into an extratropical storm right before it made landfall in the New Jersey coastline. It didn't make a difference with the impacts. They were huge, widespread. Sandy was a huge storm. But this kind of product will be coming from GOES-R on a regular basis when it's up there. And that's why the data rates and the data flows with GOES-R are going to be much larger than they are today. So those of you who may have satellite dishes, you may have ground stations that get the current GOES data in, you're going to need new ones because the data volume is going to be so large. And the processing is going to be you're going to have a large processing need to take care of all that data. This is just the legend for the temperatures, the sea surface temperatures. So you can see the Gulf Stream as it wanders up this way, up through this loop current, and then comes up the East Coast. All these temperatures in the yellow are in the 80s. So there's still warm water that comes up, you know, even in September and October, all year, it comes up here. But along the Chesapeake Bay and along the coastline, these temperatures were in the 50s and 60s. So hurricanes can't survive in that kind of water. That's why it helps Sandy do this transition into an extratropical system along with the other atmospheric conditions as well. So I want to show you a satellite image of Sandy. This is what GOES-R will be able to show you in its resolution. As a matter of fact, this is a proxy image from the MODIS satellite on NASA's Terra and Aqua satellites. So the MODIS sensor, and this is again a research to operations example where we're using a research platform to show you what GOES-R will bring. So you can see that there was some dry air coming into Sandy as Sandy was off the North Carolina coast. This is the official forecast, you know, that cone of uncertainty that the Hurricane Center puts out. This was their official forecast, and I got to tell you, it doesn't normally look like this when you have a storm turning to the left right into the coast of New Jersey. all because there was a strong blocking high pressure system up to the northeast, and it forced Sandy to move this way, right? Storms will take the path of least resistance, and it wasn't that way. It was into the coast of New Jersey. So what you're seeing here in this monitor is actual product performance monitoring at Harris when they're looking and operationally pulling in proxy GOES-R data. So that's what it's gonna look like with the systems that'll be pulling in the data sets. And that's gonna be happening every second of every day, 24/7 for 365 days a year. Now, as we dive in closer to Sandy on this visible image, you can see where the strong thunderstorms are. These are all strong thunderstorms here, rotating around the center of the storm. Here's the center of the storm. And as it made landfall here, right, all the winds are coming around this way, building up into Long Island Sound and building up into New York City. And when the water is constrained by land, it's gonna do nothing but go up. So that's why you had a storm surge coming into New York City, creating all of that terrible damage. Now on the other side of the storm, I'll change the color here to green. On the other side of the storm, the winds are coming around this way. So for example, like in Delaware Bay, they didn't have a storm surge. The wind was blowing out, and it was blowing out off the coast of Maryland. As a matter of fact, a lot of the beach erosion that happened in New Jersey, they had beach accretion in Delaware. The beach grew by 15 feet in Bethany Beach, Delaware, because of the winds and the drift of the sand. Now, that wasn't the case everywhere. Obviously, there was a lot of beach erosion to the north of the storm when it was moving inland. So this is the kind of information that research platforms have really helped get GOES-R to where it is today and when it's going to be launched in early 2016. And the bottom line is, we'll have more data, we'll have more capability, it'll help forecasters tremendously, it'll improve numerical weather prediction, but you have to be ready with the right ground stations, and that's going to take an upgrade from the current GOES-R ground station today. As a matter of fact, a totally new ground station is what's needed. That's it for this segment from Harris here at AMS. I'm meteorologist Dave Jones.